Biology, and today's lecture is from the section Parasitology. The topic for the lecture is Giardia and Trichomonas, which are intestinal and genital flagellates. So as today's topic is a short topic, we will try to go through a brief revision of microbiology subject as a whole. This is just a brief revision for your study purpose as a holistic approach. So medical microbiology or clinical microbiology or the microbiology subject of the second year MBBS comprises of these sections or branches: bacteriology, virology, mycology and parasitology, because microbiology deals with the infectious diseases. So three of these sections have already been covered. There is one more important section, which is immunology, which is directly related to all these sections, along with some independent diseases. So the response of immunity in disease and health condition is important and is studied in immunology. So all these sections are studied in microbiology, and currently we are going through the parasitology section. So in parasitology, principally two big sections are there, in which two different types of parasites are studied: protozoa and helminths. So helminths will be covered once protozoa have been covered in your curriculum. In protozoa, following are the important examples. Remember that this is not a classification of protozoa. These are just important examples of protozoa that have been shown here. So don't get confused. The classification is different. So important examples of protozoa are Entamoeba, free living amoebae, Giardia and Trichomonas, Leishmania and Trypanosoma, Plasmodium and Toxoplasma, and few others. So these are important examples. According to their organ affected or tissue affected, and today's topic is Giardia and Trichomonas. So at the end of this session, the students shall be able to understand what are flagellates, general classification of flagellates, pathogenicity of the flagellates, and their lab diagnosis. So we will start with the first question: what are flagellates? So flagellates are protozoan parasites which possess flagella. Simple definition: protozoan parasites which are having flagella, at least in one morphological form, that is trophozoite. You already know that protozoan parasites may have two different morphological forms: cyst and trophozoite. So trophozoite is the motile form, cyst is the non-motile form. So flagellates are the protozoan parasites which have the flagella. So now, classification of flagellates. Different types of flagellates have been given according to the tissue, organ or system they reside in or they affect. So intestinal flagellate, which is important example, is Giardia lamblia. Genital flagellates, Trichomonas vaginalis. Blood and tissue flagellates, Leishmania and Trypanosoma. Leishmania and Trypanosoma will be covered in subsequent lectures. There is one more important type: oral flagellates. But this flagellate is not pathogenic. So what is the example, we will see in subsequent slides. So today's intestinal and genital flagellates will be covered. Now this is the systematic or taxonomic classification of flagellates. There are very important attractive terms, new terms for you, like Archizoa, Neozoa, Metamonada, Euglenozoa. So these terms are actually very difficult to remember, but you don't have to worry. There is a point of relief that you should at least remember the kingdom, that is protozoa or protist, and the important examples like Giardia, Leishmania, Trypanosoma, Trichomonas and so on. The subkingdom, phylum, class, order you may omit. It won't be specifically asked in theory or practicals, but still the importance of this classification is not less, that you should remember. Now this is the classification of flagellates based on their habitat. So Giardia lamellia resides in duodenum and jejunum. Enteromonas hominis and Retortamonas intestinalis reside in large intestine. Chylomastix mesnili and Dianthomyba fragilis reside in cecum. Trichomonas tenax is the example of oral flagellate. It resides in oral cavity, that is mouth, and may affect teeth and gum. Pentatrichomonas hominis resides in ileocecal region, and Trichomonas vaginalis resides in vagina and urethra. There is one important subgroup, blood and somatic flagellates. So these reside in blood and tissue. Important examples are Leishmania and Trypanosoma. So today's topic is Giardia and Trichomonas. So first we will cover Giardia lamellia. There is one more common name given to Giardia lamellia. It is Giardia intestinalis. So Giardia lamellia is the only protozoan parasite found in the human small intestine. That is an important point, may be asked to you in MCQs. The infective stage, that is infective morphological form of Giardia lamellia for human beings, is cyst. And ID50, that is infective dose, which may be responsible for producing diseases in 50% of subject individuals, is ranging from 10 to 100 cysts. So first of all we will see the morphology. There are two different forms, trophozoid and cyst. Trophozoid is pear shaped, as you can see here, diagram A and diagram B is of that of trophozoid. So pear shaped trophozoid, the size range is 12 to 15 micrometer by 7 to 9 micrometer. Diagram A is the frontal view or direct view of trophozoid. Diagram B is the lateral view or side view of the trophozoid. And diagram C is the cyst. Cyst size range is 12 to 7 micrometer and it is ellipsoid or oval in shape. As you can see here, the internal structures are also there. Diagrams are important for you. There may be a short note for diagrams too. So here you can see in trophozoid form there are four pairs of flagella. That's why this parasite is called as flagellate. And the motility, by the virtue of four pairs of flagella, the parasite acquires motility, which is mimicking in action of a falling leaf. So this motility is described as falling leaf motility. So here is a short animation which is showing you the falling leaves. There is a typical swinging or swirling action by which the leaves come down. So leaves will naturally come down only, but the parasite is actively motile, so it may move up and down. So here you can see the trophozoite form of Giardia lamellia. You can see the typical falling leaf motility in the beginning. So it is coming down. Typical swirling or swinging type of movement resembling to falling leaves. So here it is moving. Now the life cycle of the parasite. In parasitology, life cycle is an important aspect to be remembered. So you know many parasites are having complex life cycle in which they need more than one host. But Giardia is having a simple life cycle. It completes its life cycle in only one host, that is human beings. The infective form for human beings is the mature cysts. Mature cyst, not the trophozoite, the cyst form. And mode of transmission, how the parasite is transmitted from person to person or from infected water or infected food. So here, ingestion of infected food and water containing the cysts, mature cyst of Giardia, is the mode of transmission. That is important mode of transmission, but rarely the parasite may get transmitted from person to person by sexual route, mainly in homosexual individuals. So here in the diagram you can see the life cycle. Here is the infective form, that is cyst. Man acquires infection by ingestion of cyst. Then excystation occurs in duodenum, that is small intestine, and trophozoites are released. Trophozoites multiply and flourish there in the small intestines, and after a certain stage trophozoite get converted into cyst by the process called as encystation. Many of these terms have been covered in previous lectures also, excystation, encystation. And after encystation, the cyst forms are released or passed in the stools and the life cycle continues. Now the pathogenicity, the infective dose already discussed, 10 to 100 cyst can initiate the infection. So as small as small dose, 10 cyst can also cause the infection. What is the problem caused or the disease caused? As the parasite is dwelling or flourishing in the intestine, gastrointestinal system related problems will be there. Very common is malabsorption. So the malabsorption could be of various types, such as malabsorption of fat, which is called as stitoria. The stitoria leads to passing of fat in the stools. Instead of absorption of the fat, it is passed in the stools. This leads to foul smelling, profuse, frothy diarrhea. Because of the presence of fat and mucus in the stools, the stools become frothy and foul smelling. There may be a disaccharides deficiency like lactose or xylose. These won't be absorbed and this may lead to lactose intolerance. Even vitamins may not get absorbed properly, like vitamin A, B12, and even iron deficiency may be there. And sometimes protein absorption is also hampered, leading to protein losing enteropathy. So now actual clinical features. As you already know, parasites have developed the tendency to grow or flourish inside the host by causing minimal harm or no harm at all, so that they can live with the host as long as possible. Because if they cause any harm, that will initiate the immune response and parasite may no longer be able to reside inside the host. So they try to live in the harmony and try to cause minimal harm, and that's why many of the parasitic infections are asymptomatic in most of the cases. So asymptomatic carriers will be there in most of the infections of Giardia also. But when infections or manifestations are there, it may present as diarrhea. It is commonly described as traveler's diarrhea because it is commonly seen in travelers. So those persons which travel from one location to other location, major geographical change is there and they get manifestation of the Giardia infection. So in common, the Giardia infection is called as giardiasis. So it can be divided into two types, acute giardiasis and chronic giardiasis. For acute giardiasis, incubation period varies from 1 week to 3 weeks. The common symptoms seen in acute giardiasis are diarrhea, abdominal pain, bloating of the stomach and belching. Diarrhea is often foul smelling because of the presence of fat and mucus. Important point to remember is there is no blood, so no dysentery. As studied in the previous lecture of entamoeba, entamoeba causes dysentery. So there is presence of blood in the stools. Here in case of Giardia, no blood in the stools. Second type is chronic giardiasis, depending on the duration of the infection. So here recurrent episodes of foul smelling diarrhea are there, and sometimes extra intestinal manifestations can also be seen, such as urticaria, and other tissues may also get involved like anterior uveitis, arthritis and so on. Now what can be done for the patient? as depending on the clinical feature or presentation of the case, the clinician may suspect that this might be a case of giardia infection. So the suspicion can be confirmed by laboratory diagnosis, and after confirmation the treatment can be started. So these are the methods of laboratory diagnosis of giardia infection. Most commonly used method is the stool examination by microscopy. In microscopy, you already know there are two methods: normal saline mount and iodine mount for wet mount microscopy. So these mounts will detect the cyst and trophozoite. And other methods in microscopy are permanent staining method, for example trichrome stain. So in normal saline mount, you will see the pear shaped trophozoite showing the falling leaf motility. This will indicate the active infection. Presence of cyst will indicate the carrier stage, or may also indicate the active stage. So that has to be confirmed by presence of trophozoites. Second method is enterotest, which is a duodenal sampling method with the help of gelatin capsule attached to a thread. The details of this test we will see in subsequent slide. Another method is antigen detection in stool, where the tri-H parasite panel is used. This is the same parasite panel used in diagnosis of entamoeba infection also. Another method is antibody detection in serology. Culture method, that is growing the parasite in vitro, is very rarely used, and it is not used for diagnostic but used for research purpose. Then molecular methods can also be used. These are also used in higher facilities only. The methods like PCR, biofire, film array or genotyping, these are commonly used for epidemiological studies or research purpose. And radiological findings like barium meal X-ray may be helpful as a supplementary aid. So these are the microscopic findings from the stool microscopy. Like the diagram A and diagram B are the wet mounts. Diagram A is of saline mount and diagram B is of iodine mount. So here you can see the typical yellow brownish color of iodine. As you already know, iodine mount is more helpful for detecting the cyst form of the parasite, and the trophozoite form will be easily seen, and even the motility can also be seen in wet mount. So here the cyst form, and these are the permanent staining methods. Diagram C is of trichrome stain. Here you can see the typical ellipsoid or oval shape of the cysts, and the last diagram is of fluorescent staining. So all these are the cyst form of the giardia, and in the next slide here you can see the images of trophozoite form of giardia. First one is the saline mount. You can see the pear shaped trophozoite form. Second one, diagram B, is trichrome stain front view, and this is the lateral view, diagram C. So side view of the trophozoite. Here you can see the flagella in diagram D, which is a Jimsa stain. So pear shape of the trophozoite form of the giardia along with all the flagella. So all these are trophozoite forms. Next method is enterotest. This test is also known as duodenal capsule technique, or simply known as string test. In this test, when a giardia infection is suspected, duodenal sampling is done by the help of a capsule which is having this thread inside, or the string. The one end of the string is outside the capsule, which is attached to the patient's cheek. After attachment of this end to the patient's cheek, patient swallows the capsule with a glass of water. So in this way, the other end, open end of the string, is attached to the patient's cheek, and then patient swallows the capsule with a glass of water. The other end of the string is attached to a weight, so that when it reaches to the duodenum, capsule dissolves, gelatin capsule dissolves, and the thread is released in the stomach and then intestine. small intestine, duodenum and jejunum. So this weight helps the thread to remain in position. So the thread is kept inside for 3 hours in position, and after 3 hours, the with the help of this other end attached to the cheek, whole the thread is pulled out, and by milking procedure, the material attached to the string is removed and examined under microscope. Remember that this test is also used for diagnosing Strongyloides torporalis infection. Strongyloides is one of the helminthic parasites. So the same method is used for this parasite also. Now antigen detection, as you already have seen, this immunochromatographic testing method, which can be used for GID infection, entamoeba infection and cryptosporidium infection as well. So directly stool sample is used for detection of antigen. Stool is filtered, concentrated, and that concentrate, filtered concentrate, is used for performing this test of immunochromatography. We get a colored band over the respective region of either Giardia or Cryptosporidium or Entamoeba according to that. The culture method is rarely used. The type of culture medium is axonic type. Axonic means there are no bacteria involved in the composition of culture medium, and the name of the culture medium used is diamonds medium. Now the last part for Giardia, treatment part. As used in Entamoeba also, metronidazole is the drug of choice. It is usually effective in more than 90% of the cases of Giardiasis. Another option is tinidazole, nitazoxanide and furazolidone. You might remember that metronidazole drug is also used in bacterial infections also. So this is one of the drugs which is used for bacteria as well as parasites. Now the second part, Trichomonas. Here are the important species included in the Trichomonas group or Trichomonas genus. The Trichomonas vaginalis is the only pathogen, and it resides in the genital tract, so it is a genital flagellate. Pentatrichomonas hominis is non-pathogenic and resides in large intestine. Trichomonas tenax is also non-pathogenic and resides in mouth, over teeth and gum surfaces. So Trichomonas vaginalis we will see in detail. So this is the morphology of Trichomonas vaginalis. One important point is that this parasite exists as trophozoite only. There is no cystic stage. So this is an exception to the common protozoan parasites, which show both the morphological forms as cyst and trophozoite. Trichomonas vaginalis exists as trophozoite form only. This is the diagram of the trophozoite form. Here you can see the flagella present, which are on the anterior pole of the trophozoite, and some other internal details like four vacuoles, nucleus and the axostyle, which is the central supporting part of the trophozoite. And the motility of this parasite is described as jerky motility. So if you are not able to see the video, we can now you can see the motility of the parasite here, the trophozoite form of Trichomonas. It is typically described as jerky or shock type motility. The parasite tries to move by jerks, that's why it is called as jerky motility. Try to play it again. So here Trichomonas trophozoite can be seen, jerky motility. So now the life cycle of parasite. The flagellated trophozoite are the infective stage as well as the diagnostic stage. Naturally, they, because there is no cystic form, the mode of transmission is by sexual route. The asymptomatic females transmit the disease by sexual route, but still rarely there is evidence of non-sexual transmission also, and this transmission is via fomites. Now the clinical features, as seen in many of the parasitic infections, most of the cases are asymptomatic, but when manifestation of the infection is there, females are commonly affected and are presented as having vulvovaginitis. So vaginitis is there, and there is thin, profuse, foul smelling purulent discharge from the vagina. In 2% of the cases, or severe cases you may say, there is strawberry appearance of the vaginal mucosa and cervical mucosa. The mucosa are characterized by small punctate hemorrhagic spots on vaginal and cervical mucosa. The other features include dysuria and lower abdominal pain. And in males, the common features are non-gonococcal urethritis, commonly abbreviated as NGU, and rarely other tissue in the genital system may also get affected, like epididymitis, prostatitis, and penile ulcerations. When there is suspicion, how to confirm the suspicion of trichomonas infection? So these are the various methods of laboratory diagnosis for the infection of trichomonas vaginalis. So direct microscopy can be done. Direct microscopy of the swab smears, or the swabs taken from vaginal mucosa and cervical mucosa. So vaginal swabs and cervical swabs are the specimens. The direct microscopy will detect trophozoites, which are pear-shaped, and will show the jerky motility. Permanent staining can also be done, and some other methods like fluorescent staining can also be done for confirmation. The culture method is rarely used, but it is the gold standard method. And one important example of culture is in-pouch TV. You will see the details later on. Antigen detection in vaginal secretion can also be done. In serology, antibody detection can be done. Molecular methods like PCR for research purpose are also used. And supportive evidence or supplementary investigations can also be done. One of the important findings is raised vaginal pH. So this is the direct microscopy. Here the GIMSA stained smear of Trichomonas vaginalis infected vaginal swab is seen. Here you can see the typical shape of the Trichomonas vaginalis trophozoite. So both these are Trichomonas trophozoites in GIMSA stained smear. This is the culture method. This is called as in-pouch Trichomonas vaginalis or in-pouch TV culture method. In this method, there is a plastic pouch in which there is a highly selective culture medium, liquid culture medium for Trichomonas vaginalis. The swab taken from vaginal mucosa or cervical mucosa is used for inoculating this culture medium, this liquid inside the pouch. And after 4 to 7 days of incubation of this pouch at 37 degrees Celsius, this pouch is directly examined under microscope. The fluid is examined for the presence of Trichomonas trophozoites. So this is the culture method, which is confirmed by microscopy. And the last part, treatment. Metronidazole is the commonly used drug. 2 gram single dose is sufficient. Another options are tinidazole. Remember that both the sexual partners should be treated to prevent the reinfection, because if only one partner is treated, there are chances of reinfection. So both the sexual partners should be treated to prevent the reinfection. Prevention part, as you already know, there is no specific preventive measure for preventing infection for both GID as well as Trichomonas. So the general measures should be taken, like personal and social hygiene, which are common or important in all the infective conditions, and the importance of hygiene is currently more emphasized because of the current COVID-19 pandemic. So we will end the session with this very famous quote of William Osler, which says, "Soap, water and common sense are the best disinfectants." Thank you for your patient listening. Stay home, stay safe.